It's the Rhode Island Rams and the Syracuse Orange, moments away from the kickoff to the 2015 college football season here in central New York. And across upstate New York, it has been unseasonably hot this week. Temperatures near 90 today. And yes, this is the Carrier Dome, but there is no air conditioning in this building. And for the months of October through April or May, that's fine. But sometimes it gets a little warm inside this building in September.
Absolutely. It's something I've experienced as a player. I played in a place called the Dakota Dome back in South Dakota. Very similar structure. You know, they have sort of the soft top and air tends to linger. There's air in here. It's just hot air. So as a player, you have to be extra special care to make sure you're hydrated and getting a good rotational type situation. You get in football shape by playing games, and this is the first of them.
Well, Matt, we're going to see a lot of true freshmen getting their first opportunities here, and some redshirt freshmen as well playing in the bigger environment, bigger than a high school setting, certainly. What are the emotions some of these kids are feeling right now as Syracuse gets ready to kick off?
Well, part of what you're trying to wrangle in is to make sure that the emotion gets you focused, and then the focus makes you play correctly. So you got to be able to still do your job. So emotion only carries to a fall. You don't want a guy sapping himself out just because of being hyped. End of the day, still 100 yards. That'll play football.
Ryan Norton will kick off the season, senior from Garden City, New York, and back deep to receive. Miles Holmes, third-team All-Colonial Athletic Association, who has returned to kick in his career 100 yards. So very dangerous to start things off for the Rams.
If you're going to come in and make some noise, a special teams game is a way to do it early.
And the 2015 season is underway. 1 yard deep, Holmes brings it out to the 15. Across the 20, he's got some space to the 30. He fumbled the football, it's loose. Syracuse has it at the 45. Dante Strickland, one of those true freshmen we were just talking about.
Well, I was just about to tell you how incredible of a return this was by Holmes, because he hits the hole perfectly, gets upfield. This is just an awareness issue. At that point, you have to tuck it away, high and tight. Held it a little bit low, and the ball awareness by Syracuse is exceptional. See the shot here from behind. He makes a nice read. You just got to watch the guy from behind. Hold it high and tight. Don't walk. You got to get that ball up. It's at 4 points of pressure. You get two, you get three. Game becomes a loaf of bread that's on the ground.
And am I not mistaken that the man who forced that fumble was the kicker himself, Ryan Norton? I think he may have been the one who got in and knocked that ball loose. Either way, Syracuse has the football first off the turnover. And a whistle before the first snap.
Play game. Offense. 5 yard penalty. Remains first down.
Well, Matt, I would say an inauspicious beginning both ways.
Yes, and it's the first game of the season. You get the kicks out here early, but, you know, obviously Terrell Hodges had a long time to think about that first series. Get out and start with an operation error. Now you get right back on track here.
There you see the numbers after missing most of last year. Only the one passing touchdown, 4 interceptions. New offense this year with a new offensive coordinator. And on 1st and 15, Syracuse gets 7 back. George Morris with the first carry, tackled by Joe Simon. There's your offense, the backs and receivers. Keep your eyes on number 3, Irvin Phillips. He is playing the new hybrid position that has been implemented by the new OC, Tim Lester, this year.
Yeah, they call it express back at times. It's a guy we're going to see moving all over the formation, pre-snap, post-snap, little momentum ball in his hands.
2nd and 8, pass deflected, it's intercepted. Syracuse gives it right back to Rhode Island. Miles Holmes, who just gave the football away on the opening kickoff, comes up for the interception to get it right back.
Well, what an amazing turn of events here. He makes the play, it's a tip pass. I think that's one of those little things you have to do on the road against a big opponent. When the rush doesn't come, you stop, you get your hands up. The little things by the defensive line make that play an opportunity for Holmes. He took advantage, net zero. Back to ground zero. Holmes does a great job of getting a play back for his team.
Yeah, the senior from Daly City, California, that's in San Francisco, is one of the real playmakers on defense for Rhode Island, along with Adam Parker, who we've talked about, and one of their safeties, Tim Wineclaw. But they are back on the sideline. The Rams have their offense on the field for the first time, and there's the new quarterback, junior from Brockton, Massachusetts, Paul Meraz. And another fumble. And it's Syracuse football. Recovered by Caden Samuels, a redshirt freshman from Ellenwood, Georgia.
Well, it's been ugly thus far, Doug. I mean, there's really no way around it. Most of these things are, they've had game operation issues, ball handling issues twice, tip passes at the line. That's not much more of the credit between just the quarterback exchange with the running back. He put it on his hip. It appeared that neither knew if he was hanging onto it or pulling it out. So these are little things you try to get ironed out in those scrimmages, but there's nothing like game action, especially in an environment like this at the Carrier Dome. A little bit sloppy early on, and those are the kind of things you cannot have on the road when you're trying to come up against a bigger program here like Syracuse.
Morris, the man in motion, goes into the slot left. Here comes the jet sweep to the hybrid. And the Rams were ready, flagged down to the field as Phillips is dropped near the line of scrimmage.
Well, and that's going to be the challenge throughout this day, this defensive front of Rhode Island, of not getting up the field too far. They're obviously trying to sort of tempt
personal
the defensive
foul.
Ends.
Flipping. Number 27 offense, 15 yards from the previous spot. Remain second down.
This Syracuse offense is designed to really test the defensive ends of the Rams, to sort of invite them up the field a little bit too far, to create spaces in that C and D gap. So you have to play discipline. It's tough. You're facing potentially an elite athlete in the backfield, a guy that's maybe a little better than you. But if you play your discipline, you play your responsibility, you'll be okay.
The clip called against Morris pushes Syracuse back to its own 38-yard line. Hunt stands deep in the pocket, fires over the middle, and he overshoots the intended receiver, Brizzly Esteem.
Intended for number 9, Brizzly Esteem, incomplete.
So far, 3 turnovers and 2 penalties, and we are not even 90 seconds into the game.
4 seconds of the game, something like that, I believe.
Well, somebody's going to win this football game. Let's see who gets it going first. There's a look at Hunt, 6'3", 238-pound senior from Rosedale, New York. Played his high school football at Christ the King in Queens. That's in New York City. He hands it off. Morris stood up at the 43-yard line. That'll bring up 3rd down and long.
Now, the charge with new offensive coordinator Tim Lester for Syracuse was in part to simplify the offense. That was the phrase he liked to use this offseason. They want to simplify things and sort of take advantage of Hunt's just simply raw ability. And part of that is simplifying reads at the line of scrimmage, the pre-snap, the post-snap. Get it down to 1 read so he can really go out and do his thing. Now, when you have pre-snap penalties, you have hand, you know, clippings and things like that, and you put yourself behind the 8 ball.
There's a look at head coach Scott Schaefer in his 3rd year as head coach at SU. He spent 4 years before that as a defensive coordinator on the draw. Syracuse gets it back into Rhode Island territory, but it'll bring up 4th down and long.
We've seen a lot of this draw action thus far from Syracuse. Again, it's sort of a challenge for the defensive line. You want to get off the ball, you want to get in the backfield, get sacks, all those kind of negative plays, but you have to settle down at some point because that has the ability to run it out of the pocket, or they'll just use that draw action and work you upfield.
Standout senior punter Riley Dixon with his first opportunity of the season. Tries to angle it. It goes out of bounds. And URI will take over at its own 12-yard line. 12:20 remaining in the first quarter. A sloppy start here at the Carrier Dome between the Rams and Orange. Early first quarter on this opening night of the college football season here in Syracuse. The Orange and the Rams scoreless. And there's the second-year head coach of Rhode, Jim Fleming. His team went 1-11 last year in his first season at URI. They are members of the Colonial Athletic Association. Meanwhile, Syracuse is a member of the ACC and has Scott Schaefer as its 3rd-year head coach. His first season, they went bowling. Last year was a struggle. You see the overall record at 10-15.
Yeah, and the charge here is on defense is to replace 8 starters. So he's in an unfamiliar situation where defense played really well for him a year ago, but now there are a lot of new faces.
They give to Harold Cooper, and he is dropped. Katie Samuels with the tackle. Well, Cooper has blazing speed in space. He's only 5'7 on the roster, probably more 5'6, but he is a real burner. So if you don't get them early, you may not get them late.
Exactly. And if you're going to have negative plays, now you put yourself in those situations where you're behind sequence, you're behind in the down set, you can't take advantage of his ability. Now we're back to spread offense, not something that Rhode Island likes to live in. They like to establish that run early.
Well, Coach Jim Fleming told us earlier this week, one of his goals for the team in this environment, in this game, was to get two first downs on every possession. Third and long. Pass deflected. Another turnover. Syracuse with it. Inside the 10, to the 5. Touchdown. Corey Winfield. The sophomore from St. Louis, Missouri, returns at 25 yards for 6.
Really a lose-lose situation there for Mraz. If he leads the receiver better, the receiver gets killed. The cornerback is sitting on this quick out route. So he goes a little behind the tight, and it's tipped, and it's up in the air. That's a poor decision by the quarterback. Actually, a poor throw as well, but really it was Nandor. Either he placed it correctly, his tight end's going to get knocked down.
Matt, I don't think it's a surprise that one of the defenses scored first.
No, not
at
all.
That's our fourth turnover already here tonight.
Yeah, the ball has been bouncing all over the field like a pinball machine out there, though.
And both quarterbacks were picked off on their first attempts of the year. That's not good. Point after is good. 7-0. Syracuse on the board first. Cole Murphy with the PAT.
Again, we're in sort of a quick read situation here. Hits the back foot, ball comes out. Quarterback's just simply sitting on the route. You really got to walk yourself out of that read and go to another. Quarterback goes and goes with the shot. And again, it's sort of a lose-lose situation. Part and parcel to this is getting some production on first and second down. If Rhode Island finds themselves in negative situations, third and 8, third and 9, third and 12, third and 15 throughout the day, it's going to be tough sledding.
Well, for Winfield, he played every game last year as a freshman, but mostly on special teams. He began as a wide receiver. This now his second year as a defensive back, and he is athletically as gifted as anybody in the defensive backfield.
Absolutely, and if you're in any situation, you pray that they bounce you like that each and every time. You take him when you can get him, and you capitalize on the play. Actually, had some real nice running skills there after the play as well.
Miles Holmes waits at his own 3. Backpedals to the goal line, and he'll bring it out again. This time tripped up, but he holds on to the football. Tackled by Strickland. Turnovers have been the story for sure so far tonight.
It was at the end of what was a gorgeous start to the game that would have been quite positive for Rhode Island. We've had a lot of tip passes. We had the ball all over the place. And you know, when you go on the road against a bigger program, you have to win turnover differential. You can't put the ball on the ground. You can't have the ball being tipped around and landing in your opponent's hands. So they're going to have to control that situation. A big part of that is getting ahead of sequence. Got to win on first down. Got to get positive yards early in the set of downs.
Another oddity of this ball game for URI is that this is the first time these players have been on this field. They didn't have the opportunity to have a walkthrough yesterday or today. Drop for a loss by Donnie Simmons Jr.
This is a great example of ACC speed, quite frankly. There's a back who's got some wiggle to him, got some explosiveness himself, but at the defensive end position, he's able to turn, run, get flat, and still run down the tailback. That's the something you're going to have to resolve here if you're URI. You can't have east-west runs. You got to get downhill and hit them quickly, because sometimes the bigger guys are just as fast as your little ones.
Right. Simmons is 80 pounds heavier and some 8 inches taller, and he was just as fast, if not faster, on that play. Mraz tucks it. He's in trouble, and he's dropped at the 16-yard line. 5 carries, 4 of them have been for negative yardage. Marquise Hodge with the tackle.
I think Mraz actually makes the right decision to go ahead and take off of this, but he's just got to get what you can get at that point. There's a small window ahead of him. We know he's got a little bit of run skill, but by and large, he's a pocket quarterback. you're going to want to try to find an early read, something positive, sort of that get back on track play, something you know he can complete, something that gets the offense moving in the right direction. Whatever that play is in your tool bag, you got to go for it here early.
Third down, a long 11. Spread formation for URI. Mirage, no time. And he's brought down. Zaire Franklin, the sophomore captain, with his first big play of the night.
Well, one of the big questions coming to this game is, well, Syracuse going to want to pressure? I mean, they're a team that historically likes to get after the quarterback with sort of a myriad scheme kind of approach. But against a smaller program like URI where they have some physical advantages, can they just simply stay back, play zone, and let the defensive line get after them? At this point, it's been a little
Rams.
Connor McHugh standing in his own end zone. He gets it away. Backpedaling and taking it at the 38-yard line. Cross midfield, still on his feet. Now finally swarmed under near midfield is Grizzly Esteem. 48-yard punt, a 12-yard return by Esteem. Syracuse football, 8:27 to go first quarter, up 7-0. Scott Schaefer was a quarterback in college, first at Ohio University, then at Division III Baldwin-Wallace College, but his defense, both as coordinator and now as head coach, has been terrific last year. Even with numbers being down, their stats were extremely good.
Yeah, 26th ranked in the country, really able to hold that team together when the offense was having problems.
Morris up the middle, dropped at the 44-yard line after a gain of 5. Well, defensively last year, there were 8 players who are no longer with the team. 5 of them signed NFL contracts. So that's a lot of talent to replace, both for head coach Schaefer and for his defensive coordinator, Chuck Bullock.
Part of it's not just putting talent back on the field. That experience counts just in sort of the mistakes you'll see early, just simple issues of being out there and doing the right thing. But we're well into the first quarter now. Things are settled down.
Hunt eludes the pass rush. Seemed to stumble, now goes down at the 42-yard line. That'll bring up 3rd down and 3, and Hunt is down. He is back down and hurt.
I wondered as he began to scramble here, he takes sort of an odd stride. You could tell he went down. Yeah, I don't know if that's the leg again or if this is an ankle issue. You'll see an oddball stride right here. Oh, looked like an ankle potentially. He knew it right away. He took a stride or two after and knew the leg was not there underneath him.
We'll take a break while they tend to Terrell Hunt. Syracuse 7, Rhode Island nothing. Well, a worst case scenario for Syracuse, midway through the first quarter of the season, you see the senior quarterback who missed most of last year with a broken leg being helped off and not putting any weight on that right foot, Matt.
Feel terrible for the young man. Year rehab, come back, and this early to have another lower extremity injury.
And so with Irv Phillips trying to find some room, we got a flag down in the field. We turn our attention to the true freshman quarterback, Eric Dungey, out of Lake Oswego, Oregon, who a year ago was playing high school football. Now he's on the field for Syracuse.
Illegal block in the back. Number 27 offense. That penalty's declined. 4th down.
They declined the penalty on George Morris, and that'll bring up 4th down.
Really the biggest ovation you heard of today was really when Terrell Hunt was introduced in pregame warm-ups. And I think this is one of the guys that the Orangemen really hung their hopes on for a turnaround season. And you could really feel the air in this building go out when he went down again with another lower body injury.
Riley Dixon stands at his own 41. End over end, fair catch called for at the 14-yard line by Holmes. Check that, it's Kyrie Denny. And so URI takes over at the 14-yard line.
Thank you.
They see the University of Rhode Island founded back in the 19th century in Kingston, Rhode Island. Of the famous alumni, I'm going with Christian Amanpour.
That's yours. I'll go John King.
All right.
it's neck and neck there, but beautiful campus down there in Kingston. Cool little area there in Rhode Island.
As a matter of fact, as we have a flag before the snap.
Full start. Number 56 offense. 5-yard penalty. Remains first down.
Sam Hartman, the right guard. You know, Syracuse head coach Scott Schaefer got his first full-time coaching job at the University of Rhode Island. And he was an assistant coach there in Kingston, and he was retelling the story of his first day on the job. He had been a grad assistant at Indiana where they had all the bells and whistles, big boy football. And so his first day on the job, he goes to Rhode Island, has to tear out carpet, has to replace old chalkboards with erase boards, dry erase boards, had to water the lawn, had to do everything, he and the other assistant coaches. It was a real eye-opener, and he said it gave him a great appreciation for those who do those jobs as he has climbed the ranks in the years since.
Well, and Jim Fleming over there at Rhode Island understands some of those issues that Schaefer handled years ago. I mean, obviously, in preparation for coming up here to the Carrier Dome, there are limitations you have down at Kingston, Rhode Island. You don't have an indoor facility to practice in. You don't have this surface underfoot. And you don't have the ability to try to play indoors and deal with some of the sound issues. And you see that as another game operation penalty goes down.
Second down and 14. Screen, and it's going nowhere for Harold Cooper again.
Well, you see a positive idea here. I see the train of thought. They're going to try to invite them upfield and create some space with a little bit of screen game. It's a good idea. It's a nice thought. The execution isn't terrible, but understand, again, you're behind in the sequence because of second 15. You got to do that on first and 10. You can't have the errors between the periods.
Last season, URI converted just over a quarter of their third down conversions. By the way, that completed pass was the first of the game for either team, and it went for negative yardage. Kind of the way the night has gone so far. Denny gets near the first down marker, but brought down just short. Chisholm with the tackle. Now, we talked about the fact that head coach Jim Fleming said he wanted his team to get at least two first downs every possession. Here are some of the other keys they're looking for.
Well, controlling the line of scrimmage is very important, and that's that physicality he's talking about. I think they've established now after a few series that they're not going to be able to win in the middle of the field. So that's finding horizontal space as much as vertical. That was a nice little pass they had there, a little catch and run play. That's going to be their best chance to potentially get some yards.
Grizzly Esteen makes the catch at his own 28. One quick move to get by the first ram, and then he's dragged down at the 36. Nas Jones with the tackle. Now, in talking to URI offensive coordinator Bill Blyle earlier this week, he talked about how the turnover ratio is now the most important stat, and the time of possession is not as important as it was 5-10 years ago.
That's that 7-on-7 league that is the Big 12.
Yeah.
That's the Baylor mentality that Chip Kelly has brought to the NFL, this notion that getting in more is a little more important than the quality. It's a different frame of mind, and certainly not one that I think URI is accustomed to. They're a pounded team. They want to run the ball first, but you're going to have to win that turnover differential in the absence of that.
And I enjoyed hearing you and Coach Blyle talk about your roots. He's from Remsen, Iowa, and he followed the University of South Dakota, knew who you were. Breaking free and into the open, down to the 33-yard line. A big gainer for the Orange. Down by contact.
Well, one of the big things that the URI defense was trying to stop today was plays over the top, cutback, and the edges. That's a loss there on the edge, a part of the field that they had targeted as an area that they could not lose. You see the gaps widening. Basically, your A-gap ends up two gaps over because they're getting washed on the interior line. You got to sit down, dig a post, make a hole.
31-yard gain for the freshman Jordan Fredericks. They go right back to him. And this time, the 2014 New York State Class A Player of the Year gets stacked up. And there goes on crutches, Terrell Hunt, for more treatment.
And he's got that sock off, got that shoe off. would be an ankle, would be an Achilles. We just don't know. It's never a great sign when the pitcher on crutches early. Obviously feel terrible for that young man. We know how hard he worked to get back out here today. And all the hopes for a great 2015 season look to be a little bit up in the air right now.
Yeah, we have not seen him put any weight on that foot since. So again, the true freshman quarterback, Eric Dungey, tucks it. Just protects the football and gets back past the line of scrimmage, perhaps. And that'll bring up third down and nearly 10.
Well, it's easy to forget, Doug, that, I mean, it's obviously we're seeing teams from different levels here, but Syracuse has a lot to work on offensively. They struggle quite a bit. They are the ACC team in this issue, but they've got a lot of sort of scheme things they're working on themselves, trying to find their own identity, figure out ways they're going to move the ball now. So they're struggling here a little bit, and URI has found a way to sort of capitalize and get them in some and-long situations.
Well, when asked on Tuesday which true freshman would he be planning on using and be comfortable, the first one named by Coach Schaefer was the man with the football, Dungey. Jump pass deflected to himself by Irv Phillips. Cuts to the 20, to the 15. He's going to go. Touchdown, Syracuse. Well, that will allow the true freshman quarterback to take a deep breath, a 32-yard touchdown.
Playing that H-back position, making a great one-handed catch here, and then just simply getting out to speed, out in space, and you see the athleticism. You see the ability to hit the hole, take off, and the pursuit is just simply not fast enough. Great job of making a play and getting the ball brought in, but really finding width here in the field. They're using the entire width of the field. Blockers that are athletic, they're able to get on the edge and block even some of those smaller defenders of the URI ranks.
Cole Murphy, his second point after, and it's 14-0 Syracuse. Syracuse 14, Rhode Island nothing. Well, the way they describe the new hybrid position in the Syracuse offense is that your DNA means you can do everything, and we saw a little bit of everything right there except for blocking out of Irv Phillips, the terrific sophomore out of West Haven, Connecticut.
It's a position where they'll often recruit receivers out of the position to play at the back spot. I mean, it's a movement position. You're going to spend your time in motion prior to snap, catching balls out of the backfield, had it been some sort of tear screen anyhow. A lot of those receiver skills, but feeling that you got a rigid enough body where you can live in the backfield well if the play calls for it. Sort of a running back slash wide receiver kind of position, and Syracuse uses it so well.
Four plays, 63 yards, took only 2 minutes. So after the interception return for a touchdown by Corey Winfield, the Syracuse offense gets on the board, and now that man, Jim Fleming, you can see it on his face. We got to get this thing cleaned up. 2:47 to go, first quarter. Ryan Norton will kick off for Syracuse. The two balls on two. Carroll Cooper back to receive the kick. Norton puts his foot into it. Harold Cooper won't bring it out. Rhode Island will take over, down 14-0.
Need to get back on track, Doug. We talked about this. Fleming's goal here was to get those two first downs. We've yet to see him be able to string those together. It'll be simply an emotional lift for the offense. I mean, you stare across, you see a uniform you recognize, you've seen on TV your whole life, and you want to feel some positives. You want to start to see a first down. It's his baby steps, but understand the game of football is going to be 150, 160 plays cumulatively over the course of this thing. So there's a ton of football to go. You just got to have small victories first to gain a little bit of that confidence back.
Give up the middle. Gain of five on first down. Clark with the 5-yard pickup. Zaire Franklin with his second tackle of the night.
Franklin's kind of a cool story. I mean, and that defense has lost so many bodies from a year ago, but Franklin really started late in the season, and actually down at ACC Media Days, he was a representative, only a sophomore, guy that has plenty of playing experience, but not so much starting experience, but has risen to almost a leadership type position.
They go to Clark again, and this time Syracuse is ready. Shooting in to trip him up. Ted Taylor outside linebacker from Riviera Beach, Florida.
Well, this is really one of those situations where a veteran quarterback that's had some experience checks out of that look. Mraz has all these guys up in the line. You got to know it's either double A's, double B's, something. They've sent too many bodies in the box for your people to go against. So you have to have the ability to check out, find something else. They're not able to do that. You ran the play that the defense loves that you were able to call.
So the 5 yards you gained on first down, you give right back on second down. Mraz has time, fires left side, caught, first down. Out to the 43-yard line. Marvin Bove. And that is URI's first down.
Well, this is really the first time we've seen them stay in the pocket and attempt to play outside both the hash and numbers. Try to spread the field laterally if you're not going to be able to spread it vertically. They're going to have to find chunk plays like that. They've done that. Now you're able to sit the front down of Syracuse a little bit and maybe find some of those gaps in the run game you haven't been able to generate in past series.
Clark, the running back, along with Mraz. And the snap goes right by Mraz. Clark picks it up and is going to try and make something happen. He's dropped at the 30. It's a 13-yard loss.
These are just self-inflicted wounds. These are the kind of things you can't have if you're evenly talented in your matchup. When it's not so much that way, you're playing up a division, you're on the road, you know, volume wasn't an issue on that play. That's not what caused that mistake. That's just concentration. You have the ability to make the play. You settle down. You just play football like you've done your whole life. You make mistakes like that, you do not have a chance.
Second and 23. Screen pass complete. Game of four by Kyrie Denny. And that'll end the first quarter here at the Carrier Dome. Syracuse, on this opening night, has lost its quarterback to injury, but the defense scored first, the offense scored second. 14-0, Syracuse after one. Start the second quarter at the Carrier Dome with Matt Chatham. I'm Doug Sherman. Syracuse with a 14-0 lead, but without its starting quarterback because of injury. The Orange has scored once on defense, once on offense, and now trying to stop a third and long for the Rams. Mraz scrambling for his life to the 35, and he's going to be dragged down at the 43-yard line.
Well, this is a lesson to the young quarterback that he'll get an opportunity to take a peek at when they go back to the film room next week. Mraz doesn't keep his eyes downfield, does a nice job of getting a little bit of yardage back in the scramble. But at the backside post, guy's running down the field absolutely by himself. It's busted coverage by Syracuse, but you're not able to find it. That's something you're often coached to do. You got to keep your eyes down the field as you begin to scramble. Start staring at the turf, expect to meet some.
Connor McHugh to punt for the Rams. Esteem calls for a fair catch. Has a little trouble with it, but secures it at the 19-yard line, a 39-yard punt. And it's Syracuse football once again. We'll have a health update on the status of Terrell Hunt when we come back to the Dome. Season opener for both Rhode Island and Syracuse. Orange with the 14-0 lead early second quarter. And the true freshman quarterback, Eric Dungey, hands off to another true freshman, Jordan Fredericks, still on his feet. And dragged down at the 25-yard line after a gain of five. Well, the official note handed to us from Syracuse is that Terrell Hunt has a lower body injury and he will not return, and it came on this play, Matt.
Yeah, I mean, it's, again, we mentioned before, it's obviously an unfortunate situation, and as a player, you know when you know. And clearly, he didn't want to take a stride even with his own body weight. That's never a great sign.
Thank you. Second down and four. Again, the true freshman Fredericks stacked up after a short game. And there is Keith Harris. He is the father of Terrell Hunt. He works for CBS Sports and made the trip up here from New York City to watch his son's return after he missed most of last year with a broken leg. And unfortunately, as you can see on his face, concern for his child.
Yeah, it's the worst situation ever as a father. You're excited for your son. You know how hard he's worked to get back here today, and you're sitting in the stands in the dark. You know, how bad is it? Is he just going to sprain his ankle, or is it something worse? It's really a helpless feeling.
Well, Syracuse said before the season they want to get back to smash mouth football, just like they always used to do around here. That's a first down completion to Steve Ishmael, sophomore from Miami, with his first catch of the year. And I'll tell you, man, Syracuse has only carried the football once outside the tackles, helping to set up some of the passing action outside.
Well, we've seen them keep it relatively simple for Dungey thus far. You know, he hasn't had to do much pocket movement. There hasn't been, you know, long seven-step drop kind of thing, read the field. It's been relatively easy reads, get the ball out of his hand quickly and create some movement in that box. We're doing a nice job of keeping things straightforward. I mean, the young man had no idea he'd be playing football today.
Dungey off the play fake, puts it up for Esteem. Incomplete. Second down and 10.
Well, it's probably a good feeling for him to get out there and get that first big ball under, you know, under his belt. You know, Dungey does not complete it. There's not really an expectation that you're going to be on the same page as some of these starting wide receivers. You're probably not working with them a ton. So there's going to be a learning process, a process of feeling each other out with all of his guys. A lot of that is nonverbal communication, and it would be an expectation that they'd be there just a couple series into his career.
The motion man is the hybrid Phillips. Flag down. First down run by Fredericks, but let's see if it'll stand.
Offside, defense, Helen's decline, result of the play is the first down.
See a little bit of penetration there by Rhode Island. They're trying to sort of line stun a little bit, but what happens when you start doing left-right sort of horizontal movements with the D-line, if you get ridden out of there, those gaps get bigger. So you have to make a difficult choice. You're going to stand in and find, or you're going to try some sort of slant games, and slant games are tough if they're going to gash you with more of a downhill running style.
Five carries, 50 yards now for the true freshman Fredericks. Dungey tucks it and runs, slides and gets drilled, and that'll bring flags from everywhere. Isaiah Hill was the first to hit him as he was in his slide.
Dead ball, personal foul, late hit with targeting. Number 24 of the defense, 15-yard penalty. The targeting is under automatic review.
Targeting is a word that you hear a lot more in college football, a point of emphasis to take this type of play out of the game.
Well, I mean, I understand the conflict the defender has. It's definitely a late hit. I mean, when he gives himself up, you can't do that. But I don't understand what the word targeting means. Are you not aiming when you're not targeting? I mean, you're trying to get the guy down. And he did what they now coach, which is to take your head out of it and turn your head. You know what happens when you turn your head? You can't see what you're hitting. So it's really six or a half dozen. It's not a winning situation. It's certainly a late hit. They deserve the flag, but I don't know what targeting means.
So it's under review. It's a 15-yard penalty.
After review, the targeting is confirmed. Number 24 has been disqualified for the remainder of the game.
So there you go. He is ejected for targeting.
Such a difficult situation as a defender. I mean, you have a program at Syracuse that loves to threaten that edge and get quarterbacks out of the pocket and run. Those are running backs. I mean, yeah, technically he's wearing a quarterback number, but he's outside the box. That's a runner who might make you look bad in space. You turn your head as they ask you to do, and you do hit him late. You have to be able to make that judgment call, but how do you expect someone to see something when they turn their head for safety? Just to me, that's always going to be a conflict that doesn't go in the defender's way. And, you know, penalty's one thing. Loss of play time, that's another, and I think that's crossing the line.
So Isaiah Hill is done for the night, and there's the targeting rule for college football.
Yeah, the rule here states is targeting of a defensive opponent with contact initiated the head neck area. And again, you saw the defender, as he approached the tackle, turn to lead with his shoulder, as they like you to do. But what that does is it takes your head and your eyes out of the play. You're not a deer. You don't have eyeballs on the side of your head. So unfortunately, you can't see that you're hitting that. And when he's gone into a slide, his head is lower. Where you're diving is actually where his knees would be. Difficult to say you were targeting a head at about a foot and a half off the ground.
Hand off to George Morris. Grabbed from behind by Ezerike. Maybe picks up a yard. Well, Morris wound up being a starting running back tonight for Syracuse. And we have seen a lot of Jordan Fredericks as well, but a lot of times, Coach Schaefer, the other coaches on both sides in the season opener, you're not really sure which way it's going to go. And it was boxing. It was Mike Tyson who always said, everyone's got a plan when you get into the ring until you get hit in the mouth.
Until you hit the mouth, exactly.
And it's kind of the same thing here in season openers with football, right?
Yeah, you just don't know.
Nice job by Dungey to avoid the rush. Nearly had a touchdown, but it was dropped by Alvin Cornelius.
Cornelius here actually does a pretty incredible job of adjusting to the ball. This wasn't meant to be a back shoulder. You often see that back shoulder fade where they throw away from the intended route. Dungey just here sends a little bit too far to the outside. He does a nice little pirouette there, lays himself out, almost makes the play. Nice job of improvising there by Dungey. We've seen he has a little bit of that ability, but weren't able to pull that one in. Would have been a huge play, huge change of momentum, obviously, with the penalty, the ejection, to be able to capitalize right off of the penalty. That's what teams like. If you go ahead and take that shot, you just got a freebie.
Now, Dungey did have a lot of green space in front of him, too. He could have picked up maybe 10 yards on the run, but he went for it. So third down and 10. Over the middle. Caught. First down, Syracuse. That's Ben Lewis, the number two hybrid on the depth chart. He was a wide receiver a year ago. Now the junior from Middletown, Maryland, onto the stat sheet for the first down.
Yeah, and sometimes that designation of the H back is just a letter designation, something on a sheet of paper. He's doing a lot of wide receiver responsibilities. They move around the formation, create confusion with the defense. They don't know how to match up against them, forces you into some soft zones. And in those kind of situations, the better athletes usually win.
16-yard gain. Back to the ground to Fredericks. Avoids a tackle. Inside the 10. Out of bounds inside the 5-yard line.
Well, what really makes this play for young Fredericks is a great stiff arm. He puts his helmet right on the crown. Player drops her head. He puts the hand out, bounces off of him, does a nice job of getting the outside a little bit of speed. That's great sort of cognizance there by the runner, being able to be aware of the situation, allow the defender to go ahead and declare, and then just to bounce right off of him.
Third run for 10 yards or more, 31, 12, and 13 yards. They go back to Fredericks. Nowhere to go that time. It'll bring up second down and goal. Naquan Thomas making the tackle for the Rams. And one of the big problems Syracuse had last year with all of its injuries and ineffectiveness at quarterback position, they got all the way down to their fourth-string quarterback, A.J. Long, who's still on the team, but he isn't even on the travel roster this year, and he played the majority of the snaps a year ago. It looks like with Eric Dungey, they have themselves a pretty good backup right now. The true freshman has acquitted himself well. A little miscommunication there with Phillip. Irv Phillips seemed to be going one direction, the pass with the other.
I don't mean to overstate this. It's never easy when you're a young player coming in, but this is the kind of offense where it's a lot of single read. You pull it down. It's a short movement of the pocket. You've got a low read and a high read, so you kind of simplify things for the quarterback. You're not dropping back and having to read 180 degrees the entire field. You cut the read down. You make it relatively simple. Run play, move the pocket, and/or. So he's doing a nice job. He didn't have the connection there, but you can see the offense with Schaefer has really put him in a situation to be successful.
Third and goal in the air. Ball is caught but out of bounds by Ishmael. And let's see if Syracuse will go for it on fourth down. Looks like the field goal unit will come out.
Well, Evans actually did a great job here at the cornerback stop. of bodying the man outside. You get him off the line. You see he's really running his route down the boundary. That means you can't take advantage of all that extra length that number eight has. He runs that a little more narrow, and then he has all that extra pad to fade away. Great job there by the cornerback of bodying him out of bounds.
Dixon the hole, and the kick is good by Cole Murphy. Nice looking drive for the Orange, led by their true freshman quarterback from Oregon. 17-0 Syracuse. Well, both sides have settled down a bit after four turnovers combined in the first 5 minutes. 17-0 Syracuse. Just under 9 minutes remaining in this first half. Nice looking drive by the true freshman, Eric Dungey, 6'3", 202 from Lake Oswego, Oregon. His passing numbers so far are solid. 3 out of 7 for 56 yards and a touchdown. That touchdown was to Irvin Phillips. Holmes to the 20, flag comes from midfield. Holmes is dropped at the 21.
Going to return, holding, number 82 of the return team. 10 yards from the spot of the foul, first down.
So URI continues to hurt itself.
Yeah, I should say, you hit the nail on the head there, Doug. It's really been the story of the first half, is self-inflicted wounds. You have an opportunity with a special teams play to potentially take a chunk back and somehow, some way get some points on the board. But if you continue to start drives behind the eight ball or have negative plays on first down, you don't give yourself much of a shot.
That was Grant Lewis, redshirt freshman tight end from Glastonbury, Connecticut, who was called for the hold. Once again from just in front of the goal line, not much doing, and the ball comes loose. Who's got it? Syracuse!
Well, I feel like Teddy Rexman here playing over the same cassette tape over and over, but ball handling now an issue. Backed up following a penalty, put the ball on the ground. The other team being more talented, we're playing at the bigger conference.
The fumble and recovery by Syracuse is under further review.
That's really not an excuse. I mean, at the end of the day, still football, got to hang on to it. You may not convert the balls or convert the first downs, but ball security is a paramount importance, obviously.
They're reviewing to see if Clark was down before the ball came loose.
I believe it's out because the defender is actually underneath him at the time the ball's being stripped. We'll check here for knees on the next replay, but he's aided because the I believe the safety here is underneath the play, rolls over the body. Let's watch there for the knee. Yeah, I think he's unbound. That might be the elbow. We don't get a right elbow is just in contact, but we can't tell from the other side if the ball's yet come free.
Yeah, it looks like that's Paris Bennett hanging on underneath. Ball was stripped up top by Luke Arcenega, and then Corey with the recovery. And that call is confirmed.
Call's confirmed. Usually it's a tough job there to overturn. It has to be conclusive evidence. That looked to me that it was really a bang-bang kind of play.
And there you see the turnover story. Rhode Island just continues to give itself no chance at the rate they're going. They give the ball to Syracuse at the 9.
Yeah, we don't even have to have an opinion on this. You could just simply take it from the coaching staff. Peter told them they're negative four in the first half on turnover differential. You don't even need to look at the scoreboard. You know how things are going.
Running back again, Jordan Fredericks. A couple of true freshmen standing together in the offensive backfield for the Orange. Dungey gives it off. No gain. Adam Parker, the middle linebacker who we talked about off the top, who was the leading tackler for URI coming back. 102 tackles, including 16 against Maine. But he's only 5'11", 223. He's in there with the big boys.
That's just a great stick, though, by Parker, stepping up in the hole and making a thud. I mean, players still got to play. You got to go out there and do your job. You can't control the other things that are going around you. The guy's active. He's a leader on this defense. At the end of the day, you just get more reps. You go out and play hard. Do the best that you can.
And Coach Fleming said, quote, he sniffs it pretty good, sniffs it out pretty good. Off play action. Touchdown, Syracuse. Irvin Phillips with his second TD of the night.
Great shot here of how they're using Dungey with that little bit of short pocket motion. Make it an easy read, make an exceptional throw. Nice little ball on the run. Keeps his body balance actually pretty decent. That's a nice throw for the young man. That's pretty good mechanics for a little short, where he got a little bit of pressure in his face and still was able to deliver a great ball.
Dixon puts it down. Kick is up. And it's 24-0, Orange. Miller Phillips flagging a new role this year. They call it the hybrid. And so far, so good. This is second touchdown reception. All Orange up 24-0. Certainly one of the smaller crowds they'll have in the Carrier Dome this fall for the season opener against Rhode Island as the FCS school visits the FBS school. But I got to tell you that the student section actually is doing very well. They handed out free tickets, which for this university, if you know anything about this university, that doesn't happen. They handed out 3,000 free tickets to every freshman who just got here on campus, and I think they've taken advantage and they've been making great noise down to our left.
Absolutely. A lot of the big plays have come down in that corner of the field.
Syracuse up 24-0. This the first kickoff that did not carry into the end zone. Nice return out across the 20. Miles Holmes. He's one of the big playmakers for the Rams, but he's the one who fumbled the opening kickoff and allowed Syracuse to get things going. Davon Ellison with the tackle on special teams. So if you're Rhodey and if you're Jim Fleming, what are you doing right now? Trying to figure out how to stem the tide, just clean things up.
Well, you press upon the guys that if you're touching it, it's gold. Your scholarship's in your hand. Do not let go of that football. The pigskin is yours. It's ours. Our fortune's right in it.
On the delay, it's Harold Cooper, who has yet to be able to find any space.
I think that's the biggest issue here. It's not a matter of what play should we run. It's a matter of when I call it, can we please hang on to the thing or not have a penalty or a negative play early. And a lot of that's just a matter of concentration. And obviously, this is a different building, but you still just have to play the game.
Well, one of the strengths coming into the season for Rhode Island they thought would be the offensive line. You've got a guy, Tyler Catalina, who has all sorts of upside playing left tackle. They've got experience across the front. The center, Kevin Galagly. The right guard, Sam Hartman. Dave Steinmetz, the right tackle. The new guy is the left guard, Michael Gilbert. But by and large, they have not been able to hold off the rush of Syracuse tonight.
Yeah, we know what the intentions are. I mean, Coach Fleming talked to us about how they wanted to sort of handle things, how they iteratively go down the field with the two first down notion, the idea of creating some space, running game early on first and second down. But when you have the ball handling issues, you never make it to your playbook. You never get into your scheme.
So again, third and long, it's third and 11. Mraz tucks it. He's chopped down just shy of the 30. Nice tackle in the open field by Rodney Williams.
This is actually a great example of the conflict a runner has or as a defender has. This is the exact same hit that got the other guy ejected. You're just fortunate enough at the time that quarterback decided to put his head down as opposed to slide. Neither defender would see the difference, and you see how difficult that is. His head was turned as well, and the quarterback slid it down, he hits him in the exact same spot, and your day's over. I just personally think that's a ridiculous rule. The player has no chance.
But we understand where the rule is coming from,
because it's all
about player safety.
Yeah,
and with the head injuries that we have at all levels and so much attention focused on it, they're trying their best to figure out how to do it. But you're right, it is far from a perfect call.
Yeah. I understand the notion of flags. I definitely think flags are the way to go, but throwing nuts to me.
We'll take a break. 5:53 remaining in the half here at the Carrier Dome. Here's the Cleveland area native Scott Schaefer, third-year head coach of Syracuse, and the scoring offense tonight already 24 points. You see, they only averaged 17 per game a year ago. They're already on their second-string quarterback, but so far so good since the injury to Terrell Hunt. Dungey on the quarterback keeper.
Well, this is an important time for Syracuse here to do some good work. You don't want to get sloppy. Some of the things have come a little bit easy, but you want to make sure that you stick to your fundamentals, that you execute your offense. Great read there by Dungey. He's doing a good job of making the right decisions. Those are usually the things you worry about the most with a young quarterback. Not so much the athleticism and ball throwing and things like that, but the right choices. He's done a lot of that thus far.
Gain of 7. And so now he has gained 12 yards on 3 carries. Handed off to another one of the freshmen. Check that, that's Morris brought down. Meanwhile, the running back for URI, Cooper, has carried the ball 7 times now for 3 yards, minus 1, minus 2, minus 3, plus 1, plus 2, and 0 for a net gain of minus 1 on 7 carries.
Really hard to evaluate a back, a young player, someone you're trying to integrate your offense more when each and every down you're getting hit before you make the line of scrimmage, penalties, all these kinds of things. The defense can really key off on you when they know what's coming because you've hurt yourself, those self-inflicted wounds we mentioned.
Third down and 1. Morris again puts his head down and looks like he's got a first down.
It's the Syracuse first down.
Tez Wilson on the stop. And the Orange will keep the football.
And again, wins and losses. You're obviously here as Rhode Island trying to win the game. It's football. You're here for that. But, I mean, one of the things Coach Filmon wants to get from this is he wants to make sure that his guys come out, play hard, play physical, play fast. It's been an extremely sloppy first half for them, but that doesn't mean there can't be some redeeming qualities to come out of this game. You still got an entire CAA season ahead of you. Get in there, do your thing, get your work done, and get something from this.
Dungey's pass caught near the first down marker. 3 Rams take the receiver down and out of bounds. Esteem with the catch, they'll give him 9 yards.
Well, that's a 1 read. That's that he takes the ball in the pocket, steps, hits his back foot, and he's immediately going with it. We've really seen the young quarterback go all over the place. He's really used all the field, made a lot of different kind of decisions, found a lot of different receivers.
And Grizzly Esteem, quite a weapon. He was hurt for most of last year, but now healthy. He runs a 4.440. He's got that burst back. A lot of space on second down. Morris with another first down carry.
Yeah, space was the issue here, Doug. You hit the nail on the head. Within a stride or two of handing off the ball, you realize they've created some movement. That's this kind of goofy Syracuse offense. It can be very effective and very difficult for a defense. If you're not sure where the ball's going, a little misdirection by some line play, and all of a sudden a misstep by a linebacker, a little too far up the field by a defensive end, and you've got Mass Pike.
Morris picked up 9, 39 yards now. They give to Lewis the hybrid, and he's tackled for a loss. A lot of folks in Central New York who follow this program were wanting for the Orange to blow out the FCS opponent.
Sure.
Last year, they went to double overtime in their opener before they could beat Villanova. And I think a lot of folks were using this as a litmus test. Are we going to be pushed to the limit by an FCS opponent?
Sure.
Or can we handle them like we, quote, are supposed to?
Right, exactly. Well, all FCS programs are not the same. We've seen North Dakota State, some of these top-end FCS programs really give good BCS teams problems.
No question. And Villanova in the CAA is a much different story than Rhode Island in the CAA.
Absolutely.
Dungey, another good decision. Now third down and it'll be 2. Selwyn Nicholas with the stop for Rhodey.
Get a shot here at Dungey. You know, pulling the ball down and making some plays. We've really gotten to see him in a short sample size of maybe 20 to 25 plays. Do a lot of different things. 1 read, get the ball down the field, move the pocket, get the ball down the field, run the ball, pull it out of the pocket, do a lot of the good things. The player seems like a smart young man.
And that's his third design run for a total of 20 yards. Pass complete, although now the whistle comes. It was a completed pass for a first down.
It's a Syracuse first down.
Sean Avant with his first reception.
Well, these are the kind of throws you're going to have to make. The knee is down. But a quarterback in the ACC is going to have to make these throws if you give you off coverage. If they're going to sag, they're going to play 5 and 6 and 7 and 8 yards off the ball. You have to hit that quick hitch, that quick slant. The ball's got to come out of your hand quickly and on target. You like to hit them on the run, so they don't have to go to the knee. But still good job at least getting the ball there close and on location.
Still it is first down, even without the yards after catch. And a timeout for Coach Schaefer to talk things over. Well, his team has settled down nicely. They turned the ball over twice in the first 5 minutes, lost their returning senior quarterback midway through the first quarter, and they have sucked it up, and so far they've done much, much better than the beginning of the year. We talked about what is the hybrid back system, and you know, Ohio State uses a similar system. They do it the best of anybody. Northwestern calls it something else. What do you see out of the Syracuse hybrid right now?
Well, it's almost, you know, an arena football kind of concept. The idea of sort of some pre-snap movement, getting somebody in a position that's faster than the guy you usually see standing in that position. Even a little CFL, you know, sort of that lateral running speed, the ability to really stress a defense to really match another kind of body type like that, where you get small where you don't want to be small.
Right, so the idea is to get Irv Phillips covered by a linebacker. No offense to you and the other linebackers. But there he goes, getting deep once again. Phillips had a step on the defense. And it looks like it was one of the middle linebackers who was trying to keep with him. Got some safety help, but if the ball was dropped in there, it would have been six more.
Just off the mark there slightly, but you're right, Doug. It's a situation where, you know, you see them align in the huddle, and you're doing this by personnel groups. You see what are, it quotes, two backs. That back's not a back. that's a wide receiver.
Yep.
A very difficult matchup for a linebacker.
Offensive coordinator Tim Lester took over midstream last year. Handoff goes to Morris. Absorbs the hit at the 30 and gets a couple more yards. 8 of 8 on second down. But, you know, the offensive coordinator said he learned the hybrid from having been a defensive coordinator and how difficult it was for him to try and stop this. This is why he has implemented it. There's Morris running over the would-be tackler, and we've got another timeout. Naquan Thomas ultimately brought him down.
You know, if you look at any of the sort of developments that have happened in offensive football over the years, most of this is predicated off of understanding what it does to the other guy.
Yeah.
I mean, you're trying to create, you know, lateral space as much as vertical space. We used to talk about who's going to be the go route guy, who's going to take the top off of defense. Now you're trying to find ways to create space in the width of the field. And guys are finding unique and creative ways to do that. They do it by pace. They keep the game moving so quickly to where you can't get reset, and you create these gaps because guys are just out of position. It's a unique way that the dimensions of the field don't change, but some of the offensive play calling does to try to take advantage of what is there.
Third down and 3. Two receivers to the left, Esteem Lewis. Ishmael to the right. Looking left all the way. The pass deflected at the line of scrimmage will bring up 4th and 3. We talk about how offenses evolve. During your years in the NFL as a linebacker with the Patriots, winning 3 Super Bowls, what was the toughest adjustment you had during that time as offenses changed and morphed and grew?
Well, there were games where, you know, I was admittedly more of a rundown guy. Mm-hmm. And if it got into that third down situation, I didn't have much pass rush to me. I was more to stop, run, play that part of game. When you play teams like the Indianapolis Colts or even the Broncos in certain years, those were games where the defense spends the entire day in nickel defense, and you lose a linebacker on the field.
44-yard field goal attempt is up. And it's no good, wide to the left by Cole Murphy. Now, he was very accurate last year as a freshman, 13 for 16, including a pair of 50-yarders. He's got the foot, got the leg, just pulled it left. And so he is 1 for 2 so far tonight.
Yeah, a little bit of a hook there. Came over the top. I've got that in my golf swing. I understand understand exactly what the young man's going through.
But playing for Bill Belichick and the assistants that they've had through there, did you always feel like you were on the cutting edge of that sort of thing, the mouse game that goes back and forth?
Well, they were always so good at it. Was sort of accentuating what you did well. They weren't trying to put a scheme out that would do that if you didn't have the people that could run it, quite frankly.
Cooper from Mirage. Nice gain on first down for Rhode Island. And that's the first real positive play for Cooper, as we laid out, his seven carries had netted minus 1 yard.
And it can't be, you know, emphasized enough here. Now, for 20 seconds, 26 seconds more half, just getting a positive play, potentially sneaking one down the field here. Incompletion there. You need something to get spirits up. You got to go into halftime to convince yourself that, you know, you still have an opportunity to go out and play good ball.
So third down and four with 22 seconds remaining in the half. Now the coaches say Meraz has an above average arm. We've seen the accuracy they talked about. Let's see if they try to air it out a little bit on third and four. Timeout, Rhode Island.
Timeout. University of Rhode Island. That's their first timeout. It's a 30-second timeout.
And Paul Meraz ran option in high school back in Brockton, Mass. And didn't really start to throw the football, as we see Dungey's numbers on the other side. He's done very well. But for Meraz, he didn't start throwing the football until he got to junior college at Victor Valley out in California. So it's all a relatively new thing.
That is very effective at it. So, again, you come back here to the East Coast and you get thrown into a system on day one where you're going up a division to play an ACC school. So it's certainly getting tossed into the fire.
Well, the coaches told us earlier this week that they evaluated 26 different junior college quarterbacks before settling on Paul Meraz. That's how much they think of it.
Bright future ahead for the man. You really have to sort of put this game, at least this first half, we're not going to say game yet, but put this first half out of your mind and just start executing as you do in practice each day. Do those things that gave them that faith in you.
And he's only been a Ram for less than 2 months. I mean, he got on campus mid-July and has had to pick up a lot quickly. Meraz to the receiver coming back to him. Fondre White couldn't pull it in, and that'll bring up fourth down with 16 seconds remaining in the half. First time he's been able to target Fondre White downfield. The senior from St. Petersburg had a team high 35 catches a year ago, 304 yards, but they haven't been able to find him, haven't had time to find him. So now the punt unit back out for URI. Brisley Esteem standing at his own 28 to receive. Connor McHugh has been busy and effective punting the football. Esteem with a return from the 32. Turns the corner across the 45. Still on his feet. Inside the 40. He could go. Brisley Esteem. Touchdown Syracuse. As time expires in the half. He took it at his own 25-yard line, and he goes 75 yards.
And he challenges the edge of the air quotes defense. That's the edge of the special teams unit. Coach Filming talked about the importance of limiting big plays from the Syracuse offense. This comes from the special team where they lost on the edge, much as you see sometimes on an outside run play and an offensive play. Got to set an edge in those punt returns just the same as you would on a defensive series.
I didn't say it, but I was thinking, and I'm sure the people on the Rhode Island side were thinking, that we don't want to have to give them the football back. Even if we don't move the football, we got to hold on to it and kill these last few seconds. And we wind up seeing one of the elite athletes on the field making them pay dearly now, 31-0.
Yeah, you just saw the gap in athleticism there at the edge. You really have to overplay the edge if there's that sort of speed deficiency.
It's the first punt return for a touchdown by a Syracuse player in a dozen years. And it gives the Orange a 31-0 halftime lead over Rhode Island.
Bobby Valentine, there is an athletic director. I did the playoff game for those guys a year ago against, I believe, Fordham, which, you know, 7 degrees of separation or whatever. To Bucky Jones, former Syracuse Orangeman himself, son played for Fordham against that Sacred Heart team, and Tabucky's son is now in the NFL trying to make cuts on this difficult weekend of the end of training camp.
Well, as you know, Tabucky Jones was a tremendous player at Syracuse. Came in as a running back and wound up getting switched over, and you immediately saw, boy, that guy is good.
Yeah, and he played multiple positions in the NFL as well. He transitioned from being a top-round pick and at the quarterback spot to one of the better safeties in the league.
Opening kick taken by the Orange. Big stick. Grizzly Esteem taken down at the 28-yard line. That was Nas Jones who stopped him dead in his tracks.
Yeah, great hit by Jones. And again, you're looking for positive signs from URI. You have to support your teammates. You have to sort of band together in this thing of brotherhood. And when a guy comes down and smacks a guy after kickoff, you got to get fired up. And that's something to be happy about. You're still out here playing football regardless of what the score is. Go out here and find something positive to hang your hat on in that second half.
Eric Dungey getting the start at quarterback in the second half. True freshman who replaced Hunt midway through the first quarter. And that's another completion, this time to Steve Ishmael.
Nice little screen there on the back end by the umpire. As a linebacker, that's never something you like to see. He got these little obstructions there. He did a nice job, a little pirouette of his own to get out of the way and hope that be a completion.
Well, we've received word that Ishmael's roommate, Irvin Phillips, is out for the rest of the game with a lower body injury. So more bad news for Syracuse. Don't know the extent of it. We didn't see it when it occurred. Or if we did, we didn't realize it. There's Morris breaking tackles for a first down. He's into Rhode Island territory. So one big constant in all of athletics and for the Syracuse football team is we've got to stay healthy. We went through so many injuries last year. Two of their key players out for the rest of the game with injury as we take another look at Morris.
Does a nice job here running with patience and great vision. When he makes that decision to put the foot in the ground, he goes. It's a 45-degree angle. It gets in there in a hurry.
15-yard gain for Morris. He's now gained 61 on the night. And they go back to the ground. And it's another near first down run. Indeed it is for Morris.
Well, Coach Fleming for URI, I think at least from a game planning standpoint and doing a good job of a film study and understanding what they were up against today, really hit the nail on the head. You know, we could not give up plays over the top in the cutback and on the edges. We saw in that run there a big chunk play of approximately 10 yards. How does it come? They really just dominated and washed off the edge. When you don't win the edge in this environment, you really open up for other issues.
Morris again. Rhode Island stops him after a 2-yard gain.
Well, there's a good example of URI doing a nice job of setting the edge. That was a great edge there. The defensive end stands up the tackle. Linebacker gets down, gets in the hole. Coach Fleming knows exactly what he's talking about. When his guys in his game do their jobs, they can stop this ACC from time to time.
As a team, Syracuse gained 129 yards rushing in the first half, and they are seemingly happy to keep adding to that total. And again, that's part of the mindset that we heard in the preseason, that Syracuse wants to get back to power football. And we've seen that out of George Morris running effectively between the tackles. Timeout called by Dungey. Here's a good look at the young man out of Lake Ridge High School in Lake Oswego, Oregon. Getting congratulations, as he should. His head coach impressed, as he's been pressed into duty. Back in Syracuse, Orange with the football on second down and 9. Dungey gonna run it again, slides, this time no late hit, and another good decision for the freshman.
You see sort of the difficulty that it puts on a defense to have this H-back concept out there. I've been kind of keeping an eye on the defensive box of the Rams. And they've been trying to get away with six because that seventh guy has been removed from the box. That linebacker's walking out with the H-back from time to time. So it puts you a little thin on the inside. And as we see now, six again, with the ability to motion the guy back in and have virtually a two-back set.
And that's interesting, Matt, because statistically, the hybrids have not done a lot in terms of volume. There's Ishmael with a first down catch inside the 25. The hybrids have collectively carried the football twice for minus 3 yards, and they have only caught three passes, but of course two of those were touchdowns by Phillips.
Well, what it does is it thins the box. So it's not so much the touches they get, but by virtue of having to account for them, what it does to the center part of the field. So you walk them out, you're forced to walk a guy out to honor it. Yep. They throw it to him or not, and all of a sudden you've got a little more lane on the inside.
Syracuse moving the chains again to start this third quarter. Around the edge, still on his feet. Now the whistle blows on Jordan Fredericks. Fredericks had a terrific first half, his first college half of football. He gained 63 yards, including a 31-yarder. One of the bright young true freshmen on the roster for Coach Schaefer.
These are those environments where it's great to get these guys repped. It's a little less of a threatening kind of situation. You can just do your simplistic plays. You're getting a little more movement up front, so there's not the tight windows. Work on ball security, work on making the right read and being just an explosive, fast player.
Play action. Dungey, plenty of time. Got bodies on the right. Instead, he runs to the left. Inside the 15-yard line.
Able to see a little bit there of a decision that was maybe a little questionable by Dungey. He's done a lot of great things today, but after the play fake, he had his back in the flat, and they put a conflict on the quarterback that side. He really had two men on one. Pulled down, ran left. So it's not always going to be perfect. This is a learning situation. Even their team's ahead. These reps are so valuable when you haven't had a ton, and you've got some really dangerous games ahead of you on the schedule.
Third down and one. Dungey so far, 8 of 14 through the air, 100 yards. First down, Syracuse. Still on his feet, Fredericks spins away from the tackle, and he's into the end zone. Touchdown, Syracuse.
Well, what's so impressive here about what Fredericks does is he makes the right cut, gets in the right hole. A little bit of confusion there with the wide receiver. Get him away or go, but it's the balance that you see. Being able to bounce off tackles, not completely oversell the body to where you're going to lose balance, and allow him to just sort of pinball, bounce off, keep your balance, keep moving forward. That's a special skill. You don't see that in every back that carries a ball in college football.
PAT is good, 38-0 Syracuse. I'll tell you, Jordan Fredericks knows how to get himself in the end zone. Matt, he scored 98 touchdowns in his high school career. That a Nassau County record on Long Island.
Oh, and this is the ability for a guy to be an inside player that becomes an outside player once he clears the line of scrimmage. He took it to the correct hole on the inside, but he went in and then threatens the edge. That's a special skill. Again, I said it before, you don't find every back that can do that. Usually it's an and or. This guy has a special skill. You've seen him really make plays on both the inside and out.
Well, in this part of the country, the fans are waiting for the next 44. And of course, that's the number that's synonymous with that program, starting back in the 50s with Jim Brown, then to Ernie Davis, who won the Heisman Trophy in 1961. And then, of course, Floyd Little, who is in the building, still works for the university. Those were the big three of the 44s. There have been others who have successfully worn that uniform. And there you see before the game, Floyd on the right. And he is one of the real fixtures, and they are talking about the possibility of unretiring that number. If they find the right player, find the right kid, it is something that's been used over the years as a recruiting tool.
Absolutely.
Problem is, it's hard to live up to those expectations if you're a high school kid coming in trying to take that number that has meant so much to this program.
Yeah, first thing that pops in my mind is Rob Conrad.
Yeah.
Years ago, a fullback that I played against when he was in Miami with the Dolphins. Such a special player at the collegiate level where he's, you know, a rugged fullback body, but with the nifty enough feet where he could carry the ball and still be effective as well.
And now there are other great running backs in the history of this program that did not wear 44, like a Larry Zonka, who was more like a Rob Conrad, but didn't have 44 because his teammate and running mate, Floyd Little, already had it.
Yeah, it was occupied. It was being taken care of for sure.
And there's Zonka up top, middle, and the other 44s. And number 72 down in the bottom left was Tim Green. We caught a fleeting glimpse of him. His son is actually a reserve on the Syracuse roster now, and he is a College Football Hall of Famer. Spent 10 years playing in the NFL for the Atlanta Falcons. Here's Clark. Tripped up at the 30 after a gain of 5. Marky Clark, a redshirt freshman from Wayne, New Jersey, out of DePaul Catholic High School. Again, he was not on the two deep coming into the game, but you just never know.
No, we don't. They don't know. They're gonna mitch and match and see what works for them.
Now, Harold Cooper has been completely bottled up as their feature back. And instead of going to T.J. Anderson, a sophomore who was on the two deep, they've gone to Marky Clark. Mirage nearly intercepted in and out of the hands of Julian Wiggum. Was nearly able to pull in his fifth career interception.
Well, this is the right play call. You got the yards on first down. You get a little fullback in the flat off play action, but you deliver the ball high. You can't have tip balls in the secondary, obviously, from that position. If the ball's off a little bit, you got to elevate, stop, go get the ball. The catch and run element's gone. We've really seen the ball bouncing around too much today. A part of that, obviously, is efficiency at the quarterback position. But as a player's out there running those rounds, you cannot play volleyball. That ball is precious.
AC Rhode Island on third down conversions, only 1 for 7 so far tonight. Up top. Good coverage, but there are the flags coming in on Wiggum. So after he nearly got the interception, he's called for interference as he and Kyrie Denny battle downfield.
Pass interference. Defense number one. 15 yards from the previous line of scrimmage. Automatic first down.
We'll take a look here at the replay. My first reaction, my initial reaction is laced with bias, but my first thought was that both players have a right to the ball. And it appeared that Wiggum was just playing back into the football. They're both playing wide receiver at that point. He's not bodying up the receiver. He's trying to go past him and get the ball. He has a right to the ball as well, but that's not the way the officials saw it.
Julian Wiggum has been encouraged by his coaches to be aggressive and confident this year. He lost some of that last year as a junior. There's a tackle for loss again. Zaire Franklin. The middle linebacker, sophomore captain from Philadelphia, with the hit.
We've talked about how active Franklin was, and wow, that's a really dangerous way to go in there with a head down, but he does make a real nice play.
And excuse me, I got to correct myself. That wasn't Franklin number 4. That was Antoine Cordy who made that nice hit. Cordy, the starting strong safety from Homestead, Florida. There he is. And nickname him the Giant. He's 5'8", but his nickname is Giant. But he plays like a giant from what the coaches say. Strong guy, fearless, sticks his nose in there. And there's a lot to be said for that. Some of the biggest guys are not the toughest guys. Some of the smallest guys are the toughest ones on the field.
As a rookie in St. Louis in 1999, we had a guy on the team named Billy Jenkins. Billy Bullet, they called him. And he was small. He was built like a bullet. But he would pass through your ribs, go in one side and go out the other if you weren't careful. I've seen a guy at 190, 200 pounds or whatever virtually pass through offensive linemen. It's speed and the willingness to not break your feet and just drive it through. Be dangerous.
Third down and 11. Charlie McKeeman comes set after going in motion. Ross has his pass deflected by Wiggum. Another terrific defensive play by the senior from West Palm Beach, Florida.
Well, that's a good example of the lessons that Mraz will learn now up at this upper level. I think he actually made a nice throw here, made a nice decision. He's just a little late in arriving with the ball because the windows at this level close so fast. That's just a sinking cornerback coming off what other would have been the route. He covered 7 yards of ground from the time the ball left his hand. So you have to become acclimated to how quickly those windows close when you're playing against this type of athlete.
And Mraz has misfired on each of his last 5 pass attempts, bringing up fourth down. Grizzly Esteem. He's going to stay away. The ball goes out of bounds very nicely for URI at the 9-yard line. Well, Connor McHugh has had himself a very good night. He's been busy and active, and the senior from Lowell, Massachusetts, has the orange pinned back inside their own 10. Back inside the Carrier Dome, Syracuse comfortably ahead, 38-0. And we go ESPN College Football by the numbers. 48 games on the ESPN networks this Labor Day weekend, including here at the Dome. 450 games total this season. Of course, it all culminates with the football playoffs and the national championship game. On the jet sweep. Space across the 25-yard line for Dante Strickland. And it's another Syracuse first down. 19 yards on the game.
Alan, it almost feels unfair if you or I, you're starting to see a depth of playbook. This is a look that they've not yet seen. The ball is pulled out of the gut at the exact right time by Dungey. He makes a great read back, makes a great patience move there by sticking with his blocker. Another big chunk play.
And that's the third time we've seen the hybrid run the football, and the first time they've had a big gain. He's the freshman who has picked up the hybrid system the fastest, and so that's why Dante Strickland is getting this opportunity.
Yeah, and you see there they have an opportunity to block. So they show that short motion again, and the defenders react as if potentially you're seeing the same play. You're going to get that same carry potentially, and then all of a sudden he's in your chest and he's blocking you. So that's the difficulty, and that's why they do this. You can also counter with a bigger physical player and knock him back and make some hay there, but at this point URI hasn't been able to find that guy in the field to match him.
Second and eight for the Orange at the 31-yard line. Dungey able to get rid of the football. It's complete to Cam McPherson. First catch for the junior from right here in Syracuse out of Christian Brothers Academy. And you know who his grandfather is? Dick McPherson.
Dick
Hall
McPherson,
of Fame,
yes.
Coach who spent a decade as head coach here at Syracuse. And as a matter of fact, they are going to bring Coach Mack back next week after the first quarter of the game against Wake Forest and honor him on the field. So if you are a Syracuse fan, you don't want to be outside the dome for a chance to say thank you to one of the great legends of this program. In and out of the hands of Cornelius. You know, it's Coach Mack who took over the program from Frank Maloney as it had stagnated through the 70s into the 1980s. And this building was opened in 1980. It coincided a year before with Coach Mack coming in and just building this into a national power. And that's what Coach Schaefer and his company are trying to build it back to. And Coach Mack, always a treat to be around. He's one of the great personalities in the game. And again, they'll honor him next Saturday against Wake Forest. Dixon's punt. Fair catch. And by the way, Cameron McPherson is the second of Dick McPherson's grandsons to play for Syracuse. Mackie McPherson. He is now a grad assistant at Louisiana Tech, but he was a former captain of the Orange. He was a starting center for 4 years. So good bloodlines there out of Coach Mack. So now let's see what Rhode Island can do on offense. If it can hold on to the football and if it can string together those first downs the coaching staff was hoping for at the start. Rhode Island 0-2 all time against Syracuse. Most recently they played them in 2011 to a tight ball game. Syracuse won it in this building 21-14. Pass deflected and incomplete. And Rhode Island has never beaten an FBS school. They are 0-12 on their way to 0-13. Is it just the sheer size and physicality that's hard to match up, or are there other things that are not so obvious, Matt?
Well, Coach Fleming had talked about wanting to sort of win the interior part of the line and physicality being something that he really pressed upon. I haven't gotten the sense that they're being out physical. It's more of an athleticism and speed thing. They had trouble winning the edges, which usually means someone's either getting there or covering it up at a rate that you cannot.
Terrific catch. Despite being stuck, it's Justin Keynes, a junior from La Habra, California.
Yeah, terrific catch, absolutely. But I think the real thing here, it sort of shows what you were just speaking about, where that closing speed was there. I mean, the windows have been so small for URI today. They've been able to find a play here and there, but there's really no air on top of the play. That makes it tough. You really have to walk your way the length of the field as opposed to being able to get big chunks.
Jonathan Thomas, who closed ground so quickly and made the tackle. Third and four. Complete, but well short of the marker, it appears, from here. Another catch by Justin Keynes. That'll bring up fourth down.
Well, it's something that we We can't know from here. It's just more intimation, I guess. But it looks like he shut that route down a little too flat. You got to have sticks awareness in an environment like that. Again, young player, first game of the season, that's something you'll get coached up and critiqued on. But when you have a certain down and distance, you want to stick the route, make sure you get to first down depth before you flatten it out. Otherwise, you make a nice catch, nice play, but you still have to punt, unfortunately.
Connor McHugh off the side of his foot this time. Gets a good bounce. Grizzly Esteem says get away from it. And the ball is downed at the 30. Wasn't the prettiest punt of his many punts tonight, but effective nonetheless. It looks good in the box score. Syracuse gets the ball back on top 38-0. I'm watching senior captain center Rob Trudeau on the Syracuse sideline taking the tape off of his wrist. I think the first unit is done for the night. He and the rest of the offensive line that did such a marvelous job out of the game. Dungey able to hold on to the football, and now he's just holding on for dear life.
Like an unintentional Statue of Liberty pent there. He was spinning the ball around his head, trying to keep things interesting here late in the game. It's not in the playbook. Page 74, maybe.
Almost a little Harlem Globetrotter there going around his head.
Exactly.
And then he paid for it.
Yeah.
But he's done a nice job since replacing the injured Terrell Hunt.
He sure has, but this is what Scott Schaefer is going to be, you know, be critical of his guys. You still got to coach your guys. You don't want them to get sloppy late. Got a big game again next week, and you got to tune it right back up, so you want to hit the ground running.
So now Syracuse has its second string offensive line in. Still plenty of time for Dungey to complete the pass. It's an 8-yard gain. Cornelius with the catch.
And you see a little bit of move the pocket there. Again, they're just rolling him slightly so that he's, you know, he's got a really simplistic read. If the wide receiver hits it as come back there deep, he can make a decision or he go to his check down. It's A or B each and every time. And we've seen Dungey show enough athleticism that if A and B aren't there, C is an option for him to run. It's good enough for 5 or 6 yards.
Now Cornelius wide left. Dungey didn't fool anybody that time, taken down by Adam Parker, the junior from Yonkers, New York, who we talked about off the top, who, quote, sniffs it out pretty good. He sniffed that one out very well.
He sure did. He's been active today, and we'd expect him to come in and make some plays, but you get in one of these situations where you're down a little too much. A lot of them are just sort of rallying type stuff. But again, young man keeps his head up, keeps playing hard, keeps playing tough, sticking his nose in there each and every play. That's extremely admirable.
Riley Dixon, high spiraling punt, and it's going to bounce down inside the 5-yard line and come to a rest. There's another product of the local football program, CBA, Riley Dixon with the punt. Here's a look at the ACC preseason media poll. Syracuse sixth in the Atlantic Division ahead of only Wake Forest. Clemson favored to win the ACC championship. And there are the three heavyweights at the top, Clemson, Florida State, and Georgia Tech. But don't sleep on Louisville. Virginia Tech will open with a big test on Monday against Ohio State. A lot of talent there.
Yeah, and usually these things are driven by one of two things: returning quarterbacks or returning starters. It's a pretty simple calculation. One thing, get rolling. Nobody knows. We got a negative play here. Very near safety. Nice little slip, little swim move there. Love to see that by the defensive tackle, using the offensive lineman's momentum against them. What a fire out at you. Just get a little light, get in the backfield, show that you big guys got some athleticism too.
Anthony Judice with the hit, very nearly came up with 2 points. The ball at the 1-yard line. Mirage has it deflected again. No, he didn't release.
He caught his own pass.
Did that go back to him?
It went back to him, then he completed the pass.
So he completed 2 passes on the same play.
It was tipped. The ball's batted back to him here, I believe, by the defensive end. Does a great job. Same hand. Or same throwing arm, same hand. Bounces back to Mirage. He gets it, still gets it away.
So does he get 2 completions? Does he get a reception
and
a completion on that play?
I don't know. not sure exactly how that works.
During the previous play, there was an unusual event, and now we had two forward passes.
Unusual
in the end zone. That's an illegal forward pass in the end zone. It's a safety.
There you go. There's the explanation.
Correct use of the word unusual there.
You got it right. Well, just add it to the list of unusual events tonight for Rhode Island.
We have seen them. But you know, all instincts going to tell you, hey, the ball got batted at me. I should catch that thing, no? But
yep,
that's not the way the rule works.
Well, Amir Ely, one of the true freshman defensive ends who Syracuse is excited about, is the one who deflected the pass initially.
But it's a really nice just technique play. I mean, you're told as a rusher to go same arm or same hand, same arm. And so the quarterback's a right-handed quarterback. You put your left hand up and you mirror the quarterback's throwing motion. That was perfect. You got to time it. J.J. Watt of the Houston Texans is exceptional in that, one of the best out there, keeping his hands low, rushing to the last instant, and then always mirroring the throwing arm. That's a really good lesson that any young player can learn. Sometimes jumping around the block and trying to get the sack isn't the best thing you can do when it looks like there's nothing left. Make a play that way.
Have you been watching Hard Knocks?
I have a little bit because I've got, you know, that's New England South right now. We've got Billy O'Brien down there and Romeo Crennel, my old coach, and Mike Vrabel, obviously, the linebacker, a great outside linebacker in the NFL. And
former Syracuse head coach Paul Pasqualoni, the defensive line coach for the Texans.
Down there as well, yeah. So, I mean, it's a loaded room. You know, obviously, both quarterbacks in that competition. Hoyer and Mallett were Patriots as well at one time, so there's a lot of familiar blood down there in Texas.
Well, you can see why the Texans might want to tap into that pipeline with the success they've had at New England if they can even come close to replicating that down there.
Sure enough. And I left the biggest of them all off. Vince Wilfork, you know,
right.
Former Patriot out there doing good things.
And did you see him this week come out in his cowboy boots?
Oh, absolutely.
And the coveralls and nothing else?
Like short coveralls, too. It was awesome, though. But you know what? You rely upon your leaders like Vince, a guy that ran the locker room in New England for a decade, to keep things light. At some point, he gets a little old. He comes out, he keeps things kind of loose in a pregame walkthrough, and, you know, you benefit from those things because he's a guy that as soon as that's over and the laps are done, he's the hardest worker out there. So great leader is that Vince Wilfork.
Yeah, Vince Wilfork played for the University of Miami against Syracuse back when they were Big East rivals.
Absolutely.
Talk about talent. Those Miami teams that he was on, forget about it.
Yeah, the Jonathan Vilma was another teammate of mine. Jeremy Shockey, all those guys playing together at that same time.
All right, so new quarterback for Syracuse. It's Austin Wilson, a sophomore from Camp Hill, Pennsylvania, who made two starts last year, appeared in five games. But I would say based on the way Eric Dungey has played here tonight, from the middle of the first quarter when he replaced the injured Hunt to now when he's taken out, if Hunt isn't able to play next week against Wake Forest, I got to figure it's Dungey's job.
You would think that. I mean, we certainly don't know the frame of mind of Coach Schaefer going to the game. He may have had my backup is really a 1A, 1B, or 1B, 1C, whatever you want to call it. But Dungey did himself enough that, right, I would imagine he earned himself a start at least a week from now.
Now Wilson last year in his five games played 28 of 50 for 253 yards. On second down, it's Jacob Hill again. Hill's a 5'6" true freshman from Detroit, Michigan, out of Country Day High School, getting an opportunity here late in the third quarter.
5'6" is hard to find amongst the monsters there in the box, and when you've got an explosive player that can wait and pop through that hole, they're tough to find.
I got a name for you, Matt. The all-time leading rusher in Syracuse history. We talked about all the 44s and Zonk and the others. The all-time leading rusher is a guy not much taller than the man running the football right now, Joe Morris.
Joe Morris, absolutely, yeah.
Went on to win a Super Bowl with the New York Giants. Tough to find the shorter guy.
It sure is.
Stopped 2 yards shy of a first down, and so the punt unit comes back out for the Orange.
Another little trick those short guys like to do is to the edge players is they hide behind those tackles and they get you with those chip blocks. They like to basically are God made them right up to about your third rib. So they're really easy to slide under there if you don't find them kind of hiding out.
I'm telling you, if I didn't know you had played defense, it wouldn't take long to figure it out. Very clear that you watch the game from a linebacker's point of view. We'll take a break as the third quarter comes to a close. All orange here at the Dome on opening night in Syracuse. An announced crowd of 30,112 has thinned considerably, but we are still here. Gladly to be here for you. You can guess which one of us is the former NFL linebacker. That's Matt Chatham.
That's Doug Sherman. The camera adds 20 or is it 10? What's the saying? It's gained a few pounds there. I'm looking a little thick. I mean, this is motivation to go.
I think you could still go out there and hit somebody.
One play.
Well, let's start this fourth quarter with a little trivia for you, Matt.
Let's do it.
As the punt comes down and is caught at the 24. Name me another way you can score that Syracuse has not so far tonight. They've scored a rushing touchdown, two passing touchdowns, an interception return for a touchdown, a field goal, a safety, and a punt return for a touchdown. So what we've got left is what? Maybe a kickoff return for a touchdown.
You could block an extra point and return. No, excuse me, a block. Well, that's a field goal, so return field goal. I don't know if we're counting that a different way of scoring.
Of course, we've got the PATs as well, so that's another way to score that they've done.
Two-point play. I don't think we've seen a two-point play.
That's true. On offense, a two-point conversion.
You can call the conference the next week and get another play reversed and put points back. I'm joking, but really.
Syracuse
we're trying to get creative here at some point. Points.
They've done a little bit of everything tonight. Have the orange, and it's not been all positive, though, for Syracuse. They struggled out of the gate and then lost their quarterback to injury, a lower body injury. We saw it was somewhere around the right foot or ankle for Terrell Hunt. And he has not returned. He was helped off the field and then walked off with crutches. And then we also learned coming out of the halftime locker room that Irv Phillips suffered a lower body injury as well. And so the sophomore hybrid was done for the day. We have no idea the extent of either of those injuries.
One of the things that's been apparent, and remember, we're trying to replace the orange men, eight defenders. You notice the length that they have on the back end. Closing speed, we talked about earlier from the cornerback position. We've seen safeties close and the depth that these linebackers get. They have some nice length. It's not always height and weight and things like that. Long arm guys that cover space really well.
Mirage can't complete it. Unable to pull it in was Justin Keynes.
This is one of those situations where obviously the coaching staff is getting to know, Jim Fleming is getting to know Mraz and getting to see what he can do, what he does well, what he doesn't do well, what he needs to work on a week from now. But when he puts a ball on spot and you drop it, it's difficult. Again, that's going to go down as an incomplete pass for the quarterback, but it was executed pretty well from his end.
They have a total of two first downs tonight and 49 total yards. Jacob Hill, the return man for Syracuse, allows it to be downed by URI. And Syracuse gets it back just over a minute into the fourth quarter, all orange, on opening night at the Carrier Dome. Scott Schaefer's team has truly controlled the line of scrimmage going both ways tonight. On offense, Syracuse has run the football for 201 yards. Incomplete pass. Meanwhile, Rhode Island has gained 0 yards on the ground.
And these are the moments where coaches, you know, they become more interested in their team. You know, not more so than they already would be, but just simply real keenly aware of how they react. We all understand this is an ugly game. They understand their guys are a little overmatched and haven't played well, but you really want to know how they respond. You don't want to see guys fold. You want to see guys that have that fight in them. Maybe the other guy's a little better than me, but I want to fight. I'm out here to play football. I put pads on and a helmet, too.
And off to Hill. Finds a seam and then gets upended. Drawing some oohs and ahs from the crowd, but he pops back up after a nice game. That'll bring up third down and three for Syracuse. Jamal Custis into the game wide right. They keep it on the ground. First down. Another big game.
One of the things you'll notice here with the Syracuse offense is that they're winning on the edge. We talk about that. That you think tight ends and offensive tackles, they're really blocking well with the wide receiver position today. A lot of big guys out on the edge where they've got a size mismatch of some of those smaller URI cornerbacks, but they're doing a great job from just an effort standpoint of staying latched on out on the edge, which is providing for some of these big run plays.
That was a 17-yard gain.
Woo!
Nice spin, still on his feet. And still going inside the 25, and another Syracuse first down. How about Jacob Hill?
Well, that's the zero button. Madden, what in the world was that? That's a great move. That's one of those moves that you do in your backyard. You say, you never get away with that in real ball. We just did. That was pretty incredible. Reminds you a little bit of almost Dante Hall. You remember that name from years ago, Doug? The old returner, wide receiver, back, whatever you want to call him, from the Kansas City Chiefs. They call him a joystick, human joystick. You do those kind of things. You say, what in the world are you doing, buddy? That was a great little run there.
And here he goes again. This time wrapped up. Selwyn Nicholas on the tackle. Jacob Hill was not one of the true freshmen identified on the conference call by Scott Schaefer as one of the guys he would have liked to see in the ballgame. They've done so well, they've been able to go even further down the depth chart to get guys playing experience. Now in the jet sweep. Dante Strickland turns the corner, cuts it back, touchdown Syracuse.
Really the great thing in this game, obviously a great run here by Strickland, but an excellent job of cutting down to the edge with a wide receiver. Pulling back comes, wide receiver on the edge here, just blocking this guy, then almost takes him out of bounds. Strickland does what's available to him, takes the space, explodes through the hole. But the effort on the outside, that's the kind of stuff that gets coaches really lubed up. They love to see their guys continuing to give effort and the secondary in the fourth quarter that provides for these big plays.
Dante Strickland has been handed the football twice. He has run for 21 yards both times, second time for a touchdown, and the Syracuse lead continues to grow. We'll take a break from the Carrier Dome where the Orange lead the Rams 47-0. Dante Strickland's 21-yard touchdown run has made the score 47-0 Syracuse. His first touchdown as an Orange. A lot of firsts in this opening night in the Carrier Dome. It's been all Syracuse right from the start. Six plays, 55 yards on that scoring drive. And a nice job by the third-string Syracuse quarterback Austin Wilson just to manage what's going on out there. He's not going to be throwing the football under these circumstances, but just put the ball in the right place.
Yeah, he did a nice job, and the offensive line did a nice job to create those holes. Strickland did a great job of running through what was given and then breaking some tackles, but the blocking for Syracuse has been a real surprising up point here in this game.
That kick was out of bounds, drawing the flag. The starting offensive line for Syracuse, we mentioned Rob Trudeau.
Free kick out of bounds. The ball will be placed at 35-yard line. First down.
Trudeau is the senior captain from Farrell, Pennsylvania, the rock of the offensive line. And he's got Nick Robinson to his left at left guard, Ivan Foy, the left tackle. Omari Palmer is the right tackle. And those guys all have experience. There's three seniors and a junior. Now their new starter is a guy named Seamus Shanley. He's a senior from right here in Syracuse out of West Genesee High School. A walk-on who's barely been on the field for a handful of snaps in his first 4 years. He's done so well getting the offense down, doing his job in this training camp, doing so well. He started tonight.
Yeah, absolutely. And biggest surprise of camp this
biggest
year.
Surprise of camp. And, you know, you mentioned that Terrell Hunt received the largest ovation when introduced. I would say that Seamus Shanley got number two.
really cool story here on campus, and obviously the students were well aware. As soon as his name was called, you're right, that elevates your game.
Job all around by the offensive line to make sure the skill position players have had time to do their thing. Second and seven for Rhode. Mraz completes the pass to Denny. Turns the corner at the 40 into Syracuse territory, but a flag comes from the secondary. What would be just the third first down of the night for Rhode Island is coming back.
Holding, 86 of the offense, 10 yards from the spot of the foul, remains second down.
Marvin Bove, the guilty party, redshirt freshman wide receiver from Cranston, Rhode Island. Well, if you're Jim Fleming, how far down your depth chart do you go, or do you keep your first teamers out there to gain more experience?
I think you stick with your first guys. I mean, they need work, clearly. I mean, and again, there's the talent deficit, but you still have games, and you want to get these guys to experience themselves.
Harold Cooper eludes the first tackler, and he's brought down at the 40.
You really can't. You know, you can't buy this kind of exposure to these kind of athletes. You're only going to get a couple times on the CAA schedule. I think the more exposure, you overwhelm a little bit. That's okay. But sometimes, these things pay off when all of a sudden you're standing across an equal athlete and you're able to execute a little bit better. So you can learn from situations. I've been on the wrong end of games like these playing at the small schools. Yeah. And it's something that you can really cash in on then later in the year. You're probably not going to see a guy. I like that the rest of the season in your conference. So just continue to fight, try to get something out of it, and try to learn.
Third down and five. Mraz fires high and out of the reach of his intended receiver, Fadre White. And so fourth down and five. Well, from here, Rhode Island will play its CAA opener next Saturday, also in upstate New York in Albany, against the Great Danes. And so in terms of level of competition, they'll have an opportunity to perhaps do more things at Bob Ford Field next Saturday.
When I've been in a situation where you have that as your game tape that you're now going to review, it's especially difficult on Albany to figure out what to make of this team because, you know, it's such a different comparable to what you're going to be able to provide. So it's almost a game you throw out and you just sort of self-scout and rely upon yourself.
Meanwhile, Albany will play its season opener tomorrow out at Buffalo. First time for that program. They've played against an FCS program, rather an FBS program. As we talk upstate New York college football, we'll take a break here at the Carrier Dome, all orange. Well, at 47-0 with 9:20 on the clock, it's down to pretty much family and friends in the stands now. Another big event going on this weekend and for the last couple of weeks is the New York State Fair, which is going on just a few miles from here, just west of downtown Syracuse. And so I know the football program has tried to schedule around it over the years, but it's really hard because it's so popular here in central New York and upstate New York. It draws so many people to the concerts, and I think you've got friends and family there perhaps as well.
It drew my wife and my two kids, my 7 and 3-year-old, because there was an option to come listen or watch Daddy, and we get enough of that. We'll go to the fair instead. I mean, that's basically the your two choices. We know which way they're going to go.
Austin Wilson, the third-string quarterback for Syracuse, hands the football off. And still churning his feet was Jacob Hill, who's done very nicely here in the fourth quarter as the return man and as the primary running back.
Did a game last year early in the season with Boston College. You know, obviously a similar tight program is what Syracuse is here. Building themselves around the run game, had some athleticism at the quarterback to bring another element, and had one of these early games, I believe against Maine, where it was sort of blowout. But they got to go deep into sort of their cabinet of backs, and those backs, all those backs, being able to use them throughout the season became sort of an asset. So this is good work for the Orange.
There he goes again, another first down. Stepped out of bounds as he tried to spin away, but it's another good run for Jacob Hill and another first down for the freshman from Detroit. Well, the true freshman running backs have been terrific for Syracuse. Tyrone Perkins, Dante Strickland, Jordan Fredericks have all done very, very well. Now add Jacob Hill to the list. Six carries for 50 yards.
Well, for these backs, there's something you cannot simulate in practice. It's getting tackled and going to the ground. I mean, this is mat work. They get to get down and get hit, much like you would in a thud practice, but also fall in moments of chaos. Just get better at your craft. That's a good thing.
Stacked up for a loss that time. Individually, Jordan Fredericks has rushed for 82 yards on 11 carries to lead everybody. George Morris got the start, 12 carries, 71 yards. As a team, Syracuse averaging 6 yards per carry. So Scott Schaefer will enjoy this one until about what, 11 o'clock tonight?
His mind may have already wandered. No, I won't say that. But, you know, coaches are always thinking ahead. They're really critiquing their own guys, trying to figure out what they've got. This is the first time he's had for a live evaluation of his personnel. I'm sure he came to the game with questions himself.
Nice job to secure the football by Jacob Hill. He goes down after a gain of two.
You get to see him do some nice things. You get to see them test themselves in live situations, see how they respond to some adversity. And they had some early, obviously, with the turnovers and a couple sloppy things to start their day. The game could have gone another way, but they responded quite well, and that's got to make a coach feel good.
Now, Coach repeatedly said this week in our two conversations how much he loves this team. They had a great training camp, including a trip up to Fort Drum, which they've done the last 3 years, and he was stressing about the fact that on his roster he's got 42 kids with a GPA of 3.0 or more last spring. It's the most in the history of the program, as Tyrone Perkins gets taken down.
That's an awesome thing. I mean, that's first and foremost why you're here, but those guys with those great off-field GPAs can translate that into great on-field acumen. Those are the best things as well. You love to have smart players on your football team, guys that do the right things, guys that play the game the right way, guys that are really good at situational football, of translating what's been coached to them to the field. Every coach would love to build a program that way.
And one of the other topics we got on that I got a kick out of, listening to him talk about the number 44. We talked about it before and what it means on the football field for Syracuse as Jacob Hill gets tied up on first down. But he talked about how the number 44 means more off the field in terms of the societal message that it brings. I mean, Jim Brown was the first at 44. He didn't win the Heisman Trophy when perhaps he should have. Paul Hornung, back in the 50s, got the vote on a bad Notre Dame team. 5 years later, country's a different place. Ernie Davis able to follow that path that Jim Brown had laid out. And those are messages that Coach Schaefer has passed along to his new players. And I asked him, do you play the Express? You know, the feature film about Ernie Davis, the Elmira Express. Do you play it for your freshmen as they get in? And he said, he laughed and he said, no, as it looked like this freshman, Hill was down, but he keeps going. Gain of five. He said, no, it's funny how the kids, as soon as they learn about Syracuse, want to watch the movie. So they watch it on their own, and they all know the story of Ernie Davis and the legend of 44 before they ever get on campus.
Nice run here again by Hill. One of the things we've seen with him is his ability to stop start and to keep his balance and actually use a hand. I mean, you know, again, he's not a tall human being, so the hand's a little closer to the ground than others, but he's done a really nice job of keeping his balance, fighting through tackles, and really just being sort of an irritant for that Rams defense. They're having a hard time getting this guy to the ground, even with gang tackling.
Nice cut by Jordan Fredericks, still on his feet inside the 40. First down, Syracuse.
Well, you definitely can notice here that we're talking about a different kind of back when Fredericks comes in for Hill. I mean, nice little back cut. And again, that's in the cutback area that Coach Fleming talked about, that they had to win. They have to win in the cutback, have to win on the edges. And again, you see the speed of Frederick. It's more of a little shake and shimmy in a one cut, and he gets and goes. And it's more straight line speed than Hill, who's been sort of a jitterbug. But they have quality depth here at Syracuse. That's been evident today in that backfield.
Not much room to run that time. Fredericks is getting closer to 100 yards. Actually, he's now at 100 exactly on the 13 carries. So what a debut. Freshman from Inwood, New York. That's on Long Island.
One of the things that can be really valuable for a back in a situation like that is you find that veteran in the locker room. Maybe it's an offensive lineman, maybe it's a wide receiver, whoever has tenure, and take him aside and say, hey, buddy, great job. Nice job today, but they're not all going to be like this. And you go in and you really hardcore critique yourself. You try to find issues when they're not even really there. And you say, you know what, the hole you ran through here, it's going to be three times as narrow next time when you do that against Clemson, and you help make the guy better. You don't let him get... You don't want to impress upon him that it's going to feel like this, it's going to be like this each time he carries a football. Help you get better.
Wilson hands off again. And again it's Hill. Down just short of another Syracuse first down. Well, Syracuse's defensive coordinator Chuck Bulley used a phrase, an expression this week that I wasn't familiar with and wanted to run it past you. He talked about the fog of war. As it relates to the freshman, that you can only replicate so much until you get out there, and it seems to me that by and large this true freshman class that Syracuse has run out there has done very well in that fog of war.
It's a decent analogy, or at least metaphor, in that you don't remember much from those freshman seasons or rookie seasons. You'll remember some of the highlights, but you'll go back and watch the tape of yourself as you grow and get older and learn the techniques better, and you think, what the world was I doing? Like, you're just running. It's recess. I mean, you know five things, and by the time you graduate, you know 50. So it's fun to watch yourself and know how little you knew at that time and how you just ran out and played. And those are fun. That is that fog of war. For me, I don't even remember college. It's more that rookie football season. You'll go back and watch preseason games in the NFL and go, wow, what I didn't know on that day. First
and
10 from the
28-yard line. It was a first down, so Syracuse keeps the football and keeps it on the ground to Jacob Hill. So again from here, Syracuse will open up ACC play next weekend, a Saturday game against Wake Forest, when again after the first quarter they will honor on the field former Orangeman head coach Dick McPherson. And Syracuse has done what it hoped to do here tonight, take care of business against a CAA opponent.
You don't like to talk about injuries, obviously, because they happen. You want your guys out there playing hard and doing the right thing and executing the plays as a call by Coach Schaefer. But it really is the onus here to get out without any more major injuries. You want to stay up. You want to play fair. You want to play hard and play fast, and that's a good way to avoid injuries. But you don't want to see them when they get nicked up as they finish this game off.
So while Coach Schaefer will have to reassess after having lost his starting quarterback and his starting hybrid to injury tonight, he's got to be pleased with the outcome overall. 47-0 after a rough start. The Orange got it together and now 14-0 against FCS opponents. And their last shutout of any kind came against Wake Forest back on November 2nd, 13-0. So 1-0 for the Orange on opening night.
It's safe to say that this could have gone another way. You could have got some sloppy play out of them, but Coach Schaefer kept his guys tight, and they played well in the second half, as they did in the first.
We'll take a break, come back, and wrap things up from the Carrier Dome, where Syracuse wins at 47-0 over Rhode Island.